One of the most important periods in all of church history is the 16th century Reformation. Now, one of the things when you think about reform is what kind of reform are we talking about? Certainly in the 16th century, there was something we might call moral reform. That is to say, folks who were upset with the immorality of the medieval church, and so they sought to reform morals. Then you have others who are concerned about actually the doctrine. And sometimes folks wanted to change that doctrine from within the church. And then you have some others who wanted to bring about reform in the doctrine even outside the church. So you need to understand that when you come to the period of the Reformation, there are actually different kinds of reform. Now, one of the things I think that's important to realize when you come to the Reformation trying to get a big picture of what's going on is you need to understand that Luther, in particular, is a person of enormous significance. Luther was the kind of person with a big personality. He's the sort of person that when he walked into the room, you would know it. He's the sort of person who, as a matter of historical fact, he lived the last 25 years of his life with a price on his head. That's the kind of fortitude and personality that Luther had. So anytime you think about the Protestant Reformation, you cannot ignore the fact that we have one of the most significant, resilient personalities in the history of the church. Now, there's some other factors as we think about the Reformation that are also significant. The other being Frederick the Wise. Frederick the Wise was Luther's prince in Germany. Now, one of the most startling facts is that Frederick the Wise, as far as we know, never really embraced Luther's theology. In fact, the two men never actually met. But Frederick managed to put his life at risk, his throne at risk, in order to protect Luther. And the truth is, nobody knows exactly why he was so willing to risk so much for Luther. Now, we come to this period, you need to also understand that it's not just about theology. I think sometimes people think the Reformation is primarily about theology. But as we go through this, and as you look at the Reformation more carefully, there is absolutely no question that the question of politics and society also are very much a part of this. And frankly, there are people in the Reformation period who join the Reformation for reasons other than theological commitment. We know, for example, that any number of princes joined the Reformation not because of theological conviction, but because it meant they could increase their holdings. And finally, it's important to understand as we come to the Reformation that this is not a parade of heroes. The truth of the matter is, all of these leaders, and they were great men in their own right, but the truth of the matter is, they had feet of clay. And so as we go through and look at the Reformation, I will be quick to point out that there are, in fact, these moments where our heroes, if you will, had moments of weakness. If there's anything that moderns know about the Reformation, they know that Luther nailed 95 theses to the church door in the little town of Wittenberg. And most folks believe that, in fact, this was Luther's declaration of independence from the medieval church. There's only one problem with that story. It's not true. Luther did nail 95 theses, but it was not a declaration of independence. In fact, when Luther nailed the 95 theses, it was really the act of a dutiful son of the church. He was actually doing his job. The issue that he was addressing was the issue of indulgences. Indulgences, frankly, is nothing more than a piece of paper with the Pope's signature on it. And an indulgence essentially reduced one's punishment in purgatory. So if you exchanged some money and you got this piece of paper, it meant that the punishment that you deserved for your sins would be reduced, and you wouldn't have to spend so much time in purgatory. Well, Luther comes along, and there is this Dominican priest by the name of Johann Tetzel. Now, Tetzel was going around selling indulgences. The remarkable thing is that Tetzel had commodified indulgences. Indulgences had intended to be an act of kindness, an expression of grace toward sinners who were burdened by their sins. But Tetzel turned it into a commodity, and he was actually selling these indulgences, and he wasn't telling the full story. He had a little sales jingle that he came up with, and it was simply this: once the coin into the coffer clings, a soul from purgatory springs. Well, Luther had heard about what Tetzel was doing, and it seemed rather crass to him. And the pastor in Luther became concerned that his people were being exploited by Tetzel. And so he decided that he would write 95 topics to be discussed on the theology faculty at Wittenberg. So his whole purpose was to bring his colleagues together, other theologians, simply to discuss this question. Was this right? Was this, in fact, an abuse of a legitimate practice of the church? As you look at the 95 Theses more carefully, one of the things that becomes very, very clear is that it is not an act of rebellion against the church. There is no rejection of papal authority. There's no assertion of justification by faith alone. And further, there's actually no rejection of indulgences themselves. What it's really about is Luther is concerned about Tetzel's abuse in his selling of indulgences. Now, these 95 Theses were not intended to challenge papal authority. But what came rather clear over time is that even though Luther did not intend the 95 Theses to be a challenge to papal authority, the church, once they got wind of what he was saying, they interpreted his 95 Theses as an implicit challenge to the authority of the church. And that's where things get rather exciting. Luther's ministry, his joining of the Augustinian hermits, occurred in the early 16th century. Luther bought into the notion that if you really love Jesus, if you really want to serve him, you will become a monk. And so he joined the Augustinian hermits. And one of the things that he believed at the time, and he actually wrote about this, he said, if anyone could have earned their way to heaven by being a diligent monk, he said, it was I. Well, Luther, during this period of time, as he's serving as a monk, he's troubled in his heart. He's concerned that no matter what he does, no matter how many acts of confession or acts of contrition, still he had this gnawing sense that he still hadn't pleased God with his life, even though he was a monk. And so it's in this process where he's thinking about how do I have a right relationship with God, that he comes up with what we now know as justification by faith alone. The Latin phrase is sola fide. And during these years of intense study and thinking and teaching, Luther rediscovers Augustine. And so in one way, one might argue that Luther's sort of discovery of justification is the consequence, one, of his intense study of Paul combined with the influence of the great Augustine. Because Augustine is the great theologian of church history who stressed the importance of grace in salvation. Luther's own understanding of justification really essentially comes down to this. Luther believed that one is forgiven of their sins, not based on their works, but rather it's a matter of God's grace towards a sinner, and that by faith in Christ alone, not works, one is then pardoned or granted forgiveness. This is, in essence, the doctrine of justification by faith. Now, one of the issues that often confuses people who are trying to understand Luther in this period is simply this. When you think about the doctrine of justification, it's a legal declaration. It's God the judge granting legal pardon to the sinner. The other side of this is sanctification, the notion of living a godly life. And so you have justification, which is a legal issue, and sanctification, which is a moral notion. So the question is, what is the relationship of these two? Maybe it's helpful to put it this way. When you look at Roman Catholicism, really in the later Middle Ages, essentially the medieval church had confused justification and sanctification. Another way of saying that is that essentially they said that one is forgiven of their sins by virtue of the way they live their lives or their good works. So they confuse or identify justification and sanctification. Luther and his colleagues come along and they say, wait a second, that's not what Paul teaches. And so what they did over time is they believed in justification and sanctification, but they tended to separate them as much as possible so as not to confuse them. They wanted people to understand that it's on the basis of justification alone, on the merits of Christ alone, that one is pardoned, not on the basis of sanctification. So they tended to separate the two as much as possible. The Reformed tradition is actually even different still. The Reformed folks felt like that Luther and colleagues had pushed the two, justification and sanctification, too far apart. They wanted to stress that when God pardons someone, forgives them of their sins, it makes a difference in the way they live. And so the Reformed folks tried to bring these two, justification and sanctification, as close together as they possibly could without confusing the two. I think that's probably a helpful way to think about all of this. Now, one of the things you need to appreciate about the Reformation period, and particularly about Luther and the other reformers, is that this is a period of time in history, the early 16th century, when the Protestant movement develops, is that this is a period of intensive theological transition. It's a period of small steps, and nothing usually comes to bear or is a result in just one fell swoop. But in fact, it's a period of time where people are thinking and rethinking and trying to refine their thinking. And the same is true of Luther. Over the course of his life, he began with a more traditional Catholic view of justification, that one had to earn their salvation by doing their good works. And over a period of time, in a series of smaller steps, does he finally come to the conclusion that salvation is by faith alone. Most people who know anything about Luther, they've heard somewhere along the way about his famous stance at the Diet of Worms in April of 1521. Luther initially did not see the selling of indulgences as something that made a claim against papal authority. But the Catholics, the medieval Catholics, felt differently. They felt that implicit in his criticism of indulgences was a criticism of the Pope. Well, over the course of the next few years, after he issues his 95 Theses, Luther becomes increasingly defiant. He came to understand that, as a matter of fact, he did oppose papal authority. It took him a little bit of time to figure that out, but he came to realize that, and so he became increasingly defiant. One of the things that we notice about Luther is that by 1520, he's starting to write some very strong writings. For example, In 1520, he wrote a book called On the Papacy at Rome. And in this book, he makes the incredibly bold statement that the Pope is the Antichrist. That's pretty bold. In his address to the German nobility, in a book written in 1520, Luther argues that the church is so corrupt that the German nobles need to be the ones to take up the cause of reform. And then he wrote a book which is perhaps the most offensive in his, particularly his early years, entitled On the Babylonian Captivity of the Church. In this writing, also published in 1520, Luther challenges the very heart and soul of the medieval church, namely the sacraments of the church, in particular the Eucharist. He actually challenges the very essence of that, that is the doctrine of transubstantiation. Transubstantiation is simply the medieval notion that when the priest consecrates the elements, a miracle takes place, and the bread literally becomes the body of Jesus, and the wine literally becomes the blood of Jesus. Luther said that's absolutely wrong in his book on the Babylonian captivity. Well, you can imagine that this would create the ire of the Pope. And so he is challenged. A papal document called a papal bull is issued in late 1520. And it is argued that Luther has 41 errors in his writings, and he is urged to recant. He's given 60 days. And what does Luther do when he receives this document that demands that he recant all of his teachings? He takes the document, and in full view of all of his students, he takes the document and he burns it in front of his students. There's little doubt that Luther has crossed the Rubicon and he is openly defying the church. And of course, there's no question but that he will be held accountable by the church. And so he's excommunicated from the church in early 1521. And then in the Middle Ages or in the early 16th century, what you find is that when the church declares someone a heretic, then it becomes the responsibility of the state to deal with them and to bring punishment. So Luther is brought to the famous Diet of Worms, where he stands before some 200 of the most powerful church and state figures in all of Germany. The Holy Roman Emperor was Charles V, a young emperor, and he invites Luther to come. And in order to incentivize him to actually come, he offers him a safe conduct pass. In other words, the emperor guaranteed his safety both to and from the Diet of Worms. Now, even though this safe conduct pass is something given by the emperor, emperors don't always keep their word. Just 50, 60 years before, the emperor had given a safe conduct pass to Jan Hus. And when Jan Hus was found to be guilty of heresy, the promise was not kept, and Hus was executed. So Luther knew that for him to go to the Diet of Worms, that there was some realistic possibility that he would never leave alive. And so he goes. He arrives there, and he appears on April the 17th. He's told to be there at 4 p.m. He buckles up, he's ready to stand tall in the saddle. He goes, and they make him wait and wait and wait. It's actually not until about 6 p.m. that he goes in and the trial, if you will, began. He walks in and the imperial prosecutor comes out and says, "I have only two questions for you. One, did you write these books?" And he points to a table full of all of Luther's books. The second question was, "Will you now renounce what you have written?" Luther looks at the books and he can tell, he's, "Yeah, these are my books." But then Luther got very nervous. One can even sense that he is fearful. And he realizes that if he answers that question, will he renounce his writings, that his life may hang in the balance? And so Luther rather nervously asks for a delay. And the emperor grants him 24 hours. Luther then goes back to his lodgings. And there he prays. And he seeks counsel from his friends. And he comes back the next day. And he appears again before the emperor. And when the question arises, will you renounce your writings? Luther stands tall in the saddle, and this is what he said. Unless I am convinced by the testimony of Scripture or by clear reason, for I do not trust either the Pope or in councils alone, since it is well known they have often erred and contradicted themselves. I am bound by the Scriptures. And then he says, here I stand. I cannot do otherwise. God help me. And as soon as he finished, all of the Spanish soldiers who had encircled the room where he was speaking, suddenly the Spanish soldiers began to shout out, to the flames with the heretic. And Luther thought it was over. But Charles V was true to his word, and he allowed Luther to walk out that day alive. One of the things that people don't always appreciate about Luther's Reformation is that there were social implications. That is to say that people, when they read what Luther wrote, sometimes they took it in ways that he did not intend. Well, that happened in the 1520s with the publication of one of his works called The Freedom of the Christian Man. This book touched a deep nerve, especially among the peasants in Germany. It turns out that in Germany, the peasants had been terribly exploited by the landowners. They were treated unfairly, they were taxed, and there were all kinds of prohibitions placed upon them. And so when they read this book by Luther, The Freedom of the Christian Man, they interpreted him as saying that because of the truth of justification by faith alone, they were now free from the constraints of the landowners, and they should get what was their due. Well, one of the leaders of this group of peasants was a man named Thomas Munzer. Munzer had early on been a follower of Luther, but he kind of went off the tracks. And he began to advocate for revolution, military revolution. In fact, he makes a famous statement that a godless man has no right to live, thinking in particular of the landowners who were exploiting the peasants. And so Munzer led about 7,000 peasant soldiers in a battle near Frankenhausen against the German landowners and nobility. It was a slaughter. The nobility had trained soldiers and mounted cavalry. The peasants had pitchforks and swords. Over 6,000 peasants were slaughtered that day. As for Munzer, he escaped and fled and went into hiding in an attic. He was discovered, and he was tortured and beheaded, because in the minds of many of the German nobility, there was nothing worse than a rebel. Now, Luther had been very, very sympathetic to the concerns of the peasants. He understood their cries for justice. He knew that they had been exploited by the landowners. And so he wrote a little booklet called An Admonition to Peace, where he sympathizes with the peasants, but he is very clear to say that even in the case where there is injustice, one never, ever has the right to rebel and take up arms against the governing authorities. And so Luther recommends that they find a peaceful way of resolution. Well, the peasants did not take Luther's advice. Instead, they continued to revolt beyond Frankenhausen. There were a series of peasant-led revolts. There were reports of peasant atrocities. And Luther himself decided that he would write yet another pamphlet, this one entitled Against the Robbing and Murdering Hordes of the Peasants. And in this, Luther is harsh and unrelenting. He is famous for saying that the nobles and the landowners should smite, slay, and stab, secretly or openly, remembering that nothing can be more poisonous, hurtful, or devilish than a rebel. Well, you can imagine that the peasants felt betrayed by Luther. Luther, in many ways, was rather conservative. He wanted a reformation, but he did not want a military revolution. And so he opposed any exercise of violence. There's another social implication of Luther's reformation. In this case, it has to do with a whole notion of marriage and family. It had been the norm in the Middle Ages that when someone got married, it was generally on the basis of two things. One, how large was the dowry? So a man would marry a woman and he would receive, or she would receive, a dowry. But the other key factor was social status. Did the marriage bring about a rise in one's social status? Well, Luther comes along, and one of the major implications of his movement was a complete re-envisioning of what marriage really was. It wasn't long until after Luther's Reformation that some of his closest colleagues began to renounce their vows of celibacy and get married. Luther himself was somewhat reticent. He had said on several occasions, I better not get married. I'm probably going to be killed anyway, and that wouldn't be a good thing for my wife. And so initially, he says he's not going to get married. And then he met Katie von Bora. It turns out that what had happened, Luther had written another pamphlet called On Monastic Vows, which he said that these vows were inappropriate and that one could break these vows of celibacy. Well, that booklet made its way to a nunnery in near Leipzig, and a group of nuns read it and were persuaded that they did not need to continue with their vows of celibacy. And so they got a message to Luther, and they said, can you break us out of the nunnery? Luther comes up with a plan. He sends the local fishmonger into the nunnery. He took 9 barrels of herring, and he came out with 9 barrels of nuns. They snuck out in the barrels of these herring barrels. Well, they brought these 9 nuns to Luther, and he found husbands for 8 of the 9. There was one nun that was a little more difficult, and that was Katie von Bora. Finally, Katie decided that she would marry Luther. Luther was a bit surprised, but by that time he'd become a little bit lonely, and he decided that, okay, I'll marry this Katie von Bora. He didn't know her very well. And he even says, I think what I'll do is I'll take pity on the poor girl and I'll marry her since nobody else will do it. And besides that, if I get married, it will spite the Pope. So Luther agrees to marry Katie von Bora. On the very day of his marriage, or just before, he writes a note to his close friend and he says, I feel neither love nor passion towards Katie. And then something remarkable happened. Luther fell in love with his wife. After the marriage, he fell head over heels in love with his wife. And suddenly we find these letters talking about how much he loves Katie von Bora, how much he wants to please her. It's remarkable. And even more remarkable is how public Luther was about his affection for Katie von Bora. Now, what's significant about this is that because Luther was in the spotlight of the Reformation, it was very clear that there was no dowry to be involved in his marriage. There was no increase in social status. He was a heretic and an outlaw. She was a runaway nun. The only thing they had was mutual affection and love. And Luther, although he did not intend it, established a new paradigm for what constituted a viable marriage. No longer was it a dowry, no longer was it about social status, but now the concept of marriage was based on love. And sociologists and scholars now recognize that Luther was one of the significant shapers of the modern concept of marriage. Protestants are often inclined to make Luther a hero. And a hero he was, particularly at the Diet of Worms when he stood tall in the saddle against Charles V. But sometimes what you find is that with success, it becomes harder to be so bold. Now, Luther had something to lose with the success of the Lutheran Reformation. Well, one of his most ardent supporters was Prince Philip of Hesse. Prince Philip was one of the strongest, most powerful of the German princes who came in the support of Luther. Well, one day, Philip of Hesse came to Luther and said, "Luther, I need your help on something." Luther says, "What is it?" Philip says, "I want to have a bigamous marriage." Of course, Luther is initially shocked by this, but eventually he actually agrees to allow Prince Philip to have a bigamous marriage. Here's the backstory. Philip had married Christina, and it was a political marriage. And it was generally understood that in these sorts of circumstances where a noble person married another noble person who had a ruling authority, the husband often had mistresses. But Philip had his share of mistresses with full knowledge Christina had. But one day he met and fell madly in love with a young lady of court, Margaret Vandersall. And he wanted to make her a mistress, but she refused. Her mother in particular said, "No mistress. If you want to marry her, that's one thing, but she will not become your mistress." Now, Philip began to look at the Old Testament, and he saw examples of some of the patriarchs having more than one wife, and he said, "Aha, maybe it's biblically valid now for me to have two wives." And so with the full support of his wife, Christina, he goes to Luther and says, "Luther, will you support my bigamous marriage to Margaret Vandersall in addition to my marriage to Christina?" Luther, Bucer, and Melanchthon all agree and approve of this bigamous marriage. Why? Luther was very uncomfortable. There's little doubt about that. But now, at this point in his ministry, the Lutheran movement, now he had something to lose, and he frankly could not afford to lose the political support of Philip of Hesse. And so he made this decision to support the bigamous marriage of Philip of Hesse out of political expediency. The consequences of this were enormous. It turns out that bigamy was against imperial law. And when Charles V discovered that Philip had entered into a bigamous marriage, he went to Philip and said, "I need your help." And he compelled Philip to sign a non-aggression policy that in the event that Charles V launched a military attack against the Protestants, that Philip would promise not to intervene. And for that, he could maintain his bigamous marriage. And he did.